Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I'll talk about formal systems, in particular, first order logic, the satisfiability problem, and its undecidability. So let's get started. So to give you a bit of the context of what I will talk about in the rest of this video, let's start with the notion of an expert system. So in the first wave of artificial intelligence, as it is called, artificial intelligence started with Alan Turing's notion of machines that can take over the thinking work of humans. And a lot of enthusiasm was generated. And this goes in multiple phases, so to say. The first wave of artificial intelligence, or at least enthusiasm about it, also rounded about the creation of expert systems. And to understand a bit what an expert system is, you could think of the following basic modes of operation. You have a group of experts that formulate facts and principles. And then you intend to, based on those facts and principles, automatically derive the consequences. And based on those consequences, you would take action. So this is of course very abstract, but it gives you an idea of what you could do to have a machine to think like a human. Because if the machine can, based on facts and principles, derive consequences, it can tell you what is true or what should happen. That's very useful. But then you can raise yourself the question, if you want to construct such expert systems, then in what language, in what formal language, because it should be recognizable by a computer, should these experts then formulate the facts and principles? And once you have that, the next question is, but how do you then actually automatically derive consequences based on those facts and principles? So the first question we will treat in this video, and the second question we will treat in the next video. So what formal language do we use to formulate facts and principles? Well, it's actually quite interesting. This goes back all 100 years ago, when the famous mathematician Hilbert laid out his program for setting the foundations for all of mathematical knowledge. And this comprised Hilbert's program. He wanted to have a formulation of basic facts, principles of mathematics, out of which all mathematical theorems could be derived. So in what language can you state such facts and principles? Well, for that you can make use of formal logic. Formal logic allows you to study the concepts of what is true and what is reasonable. So what is true is, suppose you have some kind of formulation that expresses proposition. You can ask yourself, well, is what is formulated now, is the sentence that I formulate now, is that a true sentence or is that a false sentence? And furthermore, given a set of facts and the logical principle of reasoning, what are then all the consequences, the logical consequences of those facts? Well, so formal logic is a very useful tool for formalizing mathematics. And Hilbert's program was precisely that, to formalize all of the mathematical knowledge out there. So from out of this program, I mean, 100 years is a lot of time, a field of study developed, which is called mathematical logic. And in mathematical logic, one applies formal logic to study and understand mathematics. And as such, it can serve as the foundation of mathematics. And mathematical logic itself has a number of interesting subfields. I will name a few so that you get an idea of into what is developed, in case you want to study it further. You have set theory, or axiomatic set theory, which is all about the construction of potentially infinite, or actually infinite, mathematical objects. And then there is model theory, which is built on top of set theory, which is a way to understand formal logic based on top of set theory. So you could interpret formal logic in a rigorous manner. And that allows you to construct models that are then the support of theories. Another interesting field of mathematical logic is proof theory. And proof theory is the construction of formal proofs, which then can be used to support arguments. And so a formal proof you could understand as a construction in which facts and principles are combined to construct a larger argument. And finally, an important subfield of mathematical logic is computability theory, because that allows you to understand what is actually computable. What proofs could be given automatically by the machine. Now, it turns, why do I say this? Why do I give you this background of Hilbert's program 100 years ago? Well, it turns out that a lot of concepts from mathematical logic are very useful in computer science as well. And if you want to understand how that then is, how you could see that, there is this very interesting article called On the Unusual Effectiveness of Logic in Computer Science. And to summarize it in one sentence, this article basically builds on top of an article by Hemming, who states on the unusual effectiveness of analysis or of mathematics in the natural sciences. So there is a nice analogy that you have mathematical analysis, which is very useful, for instance, when you want to study physics. Well, it turns out that mathematical logic is a very, very useful ground, very fruitful ground for studying computer science. So, and in this video, I will explain the very basics of mathematical logic so you get an understanding of that. So the language that I referred to, this formal language that I referred to, in which you can formulate facts and principles about the world, let's introduce that as what is called first order logic. It is also called predicate logic or quantification theory, depending on the paper that you read, but they all amount to the same thing, which I will explain now. What is first order logic? In first order logic, it's a very general way of formulating knowledge, logical way, namely by starting out with a signature which defines what you could write down. And a signature consists of constant symbols, consists of function symbols, and consists of relation symbols. And then with these fixed signature, with these fixed symbols, you could then formulate terms. The terms are defined by, and this is an abstract grammar, by either variables, so that's what I mean here with an X, or by constant symbols, that's what I mean here with the C, or you could form applications of terms to functions. Well, function symbols, to be formally correct. So suppose that you have a function symbol with a particular arity, and it's the number of arguments that it takes, then you could construct a term by applying so many terms to that function symbol. So when you then have the terms, you can then define what are the formulas in first order logic. And the formulas, let's use the Greek letter phi to write them down. And so this you can understand as standing in this case for a non-terminal, but later on when you see phi, it stands for an arbitrary formula that is constructed according to this abstract grammar. You have the bottom symbol, which stands for the falsehood formula. You can take a relation symbol R out of your signature, which has itself a fixed arity just like function symbols, and then for that particular arity supply so many terms to be applied to the relation symbol. You have equality between terms, you have implication between two formulas, and you have universal quantification over a variable. So in this case you can read that this itself is a formula in which the subformula phi, the variable x, is quantified universally. And with the formulas and terms you can now formulate the facts that you want to use to describe the world around you. Okay, I should say the following. Maybe you remember from previous videos, but just like we have in programming, there are the notions of free and bound variables. So whenever you have a formula in which certain terms occur, in which there is a variable occurrence, well, then you can ask yourself, is there higher up in the formula the universal quantifier for all x to which that variable occurrence then becomes bound? Now, if there is no such quantifier surrounding a variable, then the variable is said to be occurring free. There's also a notion that is called ground terms. And the terms themselves allow you to make use of variables, but if you have terms that are constructed purely out of constant symbols and function symbols applied to ground terms themselves, then the overall result is a ground term. And why are these called ground terms? Because the value of these ground terms, as I will explain later what that is, does not depend on the value of a variable. And finally, there is the notion of a sentence, and a sentence is defined to be a formula without any free variables. Okay, so with these syntactical notions, you can then write down formulas which capture, for instance, you can ask an expert, could you write down a set of facts, making use of a fixed signature in which you can fix the knowledge in which you lay down the knowledge that you want to capture. So you might most likely have seen first order or predicate logic before. So then you can ask yourself the question, hey, but where are the logical connectives? We only here have the implication connective between two formulas, but where is the rest? Where is conjunction? Where is disjunction? Where is negation? Well, for that we can introduce syntactical sugar. It turns out that this is sufficient for, this is the principal syntax, and then you can extend your syntax with abbreviations, with syntactical sugar to make formulas intuitively more easy to read and also shorter to write down. So let's introduce the following abbreviations. So whenever you have the negation of a particular formula, you could read that as if it is an implication of that formula to this falsehood formula, to this bottom. And whenever you have that s is not equal to t, that's the same as the negation of the formula that the term s is equal to the term t. And now whenever you want to have the disjunction between the formula phi and the formula psi, this disjunction could be understood as an abbreviation for the following nested implication, where on the left of the outer implication you have phi implies psi, and then on the right you have psi. And for conjunction you can then use De Morgan-like encoding, in which you say, well, it is the case that phi and psi is formed by the negation of a disjunction of the negated phi and the negated psi. And finally, you can introduce existential quantification as the negation of phi for all x, and then that itself is then negated as well. So that these abbreviations make intuitive sense can be argued as follows. I mean, you probably have already some experience with assigning truth values to formulas in predicate logic. So how would you assign a truth value to a formula such as phi or psi? Well, suppose that phi is true. Well, then you also know that phi or psi is true. That's this property of a disjunction. If one of the disjuncts is true, then the overall disjunction is also true. So does that also hold in the case where we make use of the abbreviation on the right-hand side? Well, that is the case, because suppose that phi is true, then why is now this formula over here true? Well, suppose phi is true, and suppose phi implies psi is true, then those two combined lead you indeed to the truth of psi. But now suppose in the other case the psi is true, well, then you immediately have the psi is true. So in both cases, the veracity, or whenever the formula is true, it is preserved by whatever is intuitive on the left. So what you already have seen before in a course on logic. But that is also the case for the abbreviation as introduced here. And the same thing applies for conjunction. So the intuitive notion of disjunction and conjunction is here the same. So now, formally speaking, because these formulas, the set of all formulas, is it can be considered a formal language. So indeed, we can define a grammar for it. We can implement a parser for it. We can make the computer recognize our strings of symbols, and as such, we can make writing formulas easier. We can drop parentheses, and we may use dots like we have seen in the lambda calculus. But for that, there are some rules needed for disambiguating certain strings of symbols. And for that, you can make use of the standard disambiguation rules, such that the negation and the quantifiers have the highest precedence, and then followed in order by conjunction, disjunction, and implication. And you can also say, well, in the case of ambiguity because of lack of parentheses, the binary connectives all associate to the right. This is also standard. So an example would be then, if you have a formula stated like this, this is an ambiguous formula because we have dropped the parentheses. But because of our disambiguation rules, we could then indeed see, okay, how can we interpret this? Well, the last connective, that is the with the lowest precedence, is the implication. So that one is the topmost symbol. And then everything on the left is the antecedent and the bot formula, and the bottom formula, the falsehood formula on the right is the conclusion. Now, on the left, you can see, okay, we have a disjunction and a conjunction. It is the case that this existential quantifier binds more strong than the disjunction and the conjunction. So that's why these parentheses around here are stated. From the left to the right, so conjunction has a higher precedence than disjunction. So that's why the brackets are put around here. But this is considered all standard in predicate logic. Okay, so now we can formulate formulas in our predicate logic or in our first order logic. What can we do with these formulas? Well, let me first give you an example. An example of how you could, for instance, formulate certain basic facts. Say you want to state facts about the mathematical integers. Then you have to first fix what is your signature. What are the basic symbols that comprise your language? Well, and let's choose as constant symbols the integers themselves. So we have as constant symbols 0, minus 1, 1, minus 2, 2, etc. And let's introduce a single binary relation symbol, the lesser than symbol. So now we could, with the signature, we could then construct the following formulas. Or the following formula. In this formula, you see, okay, we have an implication over here, a conjunction. We have an inequality between the variables x and y. We have that it is not the relation y smaller than x. By the way, here I use what is called infix notation. So what you could understand as this x and then infix smaller than y is that this relation symbol has two terms applied to it. Namely, the first term is x and the second term is y. And the same thing here. So to this relation symbol, the term which is the variable y and the term which is the variable x are applied. And then you can intuitively read the formula as it is stated here. If x is smaller than y, then it is the case that x is not equal to y, and it is the case that y is not smaller than x. Another example formula is where we make use of quantification. So here we say for all x, and x here is a variable, x is smaller than 5 implies that x is smaller than 4. And now let me revisit the previous formula, because you can then indeed ask yourself, what are the free variables over here? Well, the variable occurrences that you see in this formula are not bound by any of the quantifiers around it, because there are no quantifiers around it. So x and y are both free variables. And in the formula over here, you can ask yourself, well, is this variable occurrence occurring free? No, because surrounding it is a quantifier. So we here have as well the notion of variable binding. Finally, you can say, well, there exists an x such that 0 is smaller than x. And you can formulate the formula which expresses that for all y, there exists an x such that y is smaller than x. So these are just example formulas that you could construct. Now, we want to give meaning to these formulas. How can we do that? Well, for a given signature, so you have fixed the constant symbols, the function symbols, the relation symbols, you can give an interpretation, let's say I, and this interpretation is then used whenever we give meaning to terms and formulas. And an interpretation consists of a universe of values, that is sometimes also called the domain of discourse. So those are the values that the terms could get. And now it is an interpretation because we interpret the symbols of the signature. So that means that the constant symbol C of the signature gets the value in the interpretation I of a C superscript I. Right? So this stands for some value in the universe of values. And for every function symbol, there is a function which ranges over the same over tuples of values, such that the size, the length of the tuple, is the same as the arity of the function, and it ranges over that, and it produces another value. So that is how you interpret function symbols. And the relation symbols are interpreted as sets of tuples or as relations within your interpretation. So that allows you then to assign meaning to the otherwise syntactic notion of symbols occurring in formulas and terms. And now whenever you have an interpretation, it's not sufficient to give meaning to terms and to formulas. You furthermore need to have a state, and sometimes this is also called a valuation. And a state assigns to every variable a value. And let's write sigma x for the value of the variable x. And it should be noted that the state depends on the interpretation. Because in the interpretation, we know what is the universe of values that we are talking about. And in the state, we assign variables precisely to values of that universe in the interpretation. Okay, so then now, what can we then say about our previous example in arithmetic? Well, we had the signature of 0, minus 1, 1, minus 2, etc. And we had the relation symbol, which was a binary less than symbol. But these symbols don't mean anything yet. If we want to give them meaning, we have to give an interpretation of the symbols. So the standard interpretation is the standard interpretation for the integers. What do you then take as the universe of values? Well, those are precisely the integers 0, minus 1, 1, minus 2, 2, etc. And how do you interpret the smaller than relation symbol? Well, as the smaller than relation on those integers. So that is the usual way you would work in arithmetic. But it is entirely possible, and this I should say, because to you it may seem maybe nonsensical to give different interpretations to these symbols. But it does if you try to place yourself in the position of the machine, and the machine has no intuitive notion of what the integers are. So the machine is free to interpret the symbols as it pleases. So when we analyze what the machine does when it automatically reasons about formulas, we have to consider multiple possible interpretations that you could give to symbols that are in the signature. So as such, you can also imagine that there exists another interpretation of the signature that is stated here, namely the interpretation where there is only one value, and that's, let's call it then a trivial value. There is only one value, and all the constant symbols are all interpreted to have that value. And then we could, for instance, say what is then the binary smaller than relation. Let's say that it doesn't hold for any of the values. There is another interpretation possible. Just purely looking at the symbols, you could freely give an interpretation as you like. So you could also say, well, let's just have three values, say minus 1, 0, and 1. And now I interpret 0 as 0, and minus 1 as minus 1, and 1 as 1. That's all fine. But now I interpret minus 2 being minus 1, minus 3 as minus 1, etc. And I interpret 2 and 3 and 4, etc. to be the value 1. So I then only effectively interpret the constant symbols as that I want to know what their sign is. Are they negative? Are they zero? Or are they positive? And then you could also interpret the relation symbol as if it is a relation less than relation only on these values. And there are many more, countless interpretations. So now given an interpretation, an arbitrary interpretation for that matter, and a state, then we can now understand what is the meaning of a term. We can give it a meaning. And for that, let's say the denotation of a term, so the meaning or the value of a term, is defined following the structure of the term. And since the term was defined in the abstract grammar to either be a variable or a constant symbol, or a function symbol of arity n applied to n terms, let's consider those three cases. So what is the meaning of a variable in interpretation I and sigma, state sigma? Well, then you just look up the variable x in the state sigma, and whatever value that has, that is the value of the variable. And whenever you encounter a constant symbol, well, then you can look in your interpretation, and the interpretation assigns a value to a constant symbol. So then you know what is the value, what is the denotation of a constant symbol? Well, that is precisely the value that is assigned to that constant symbol by the interpretation. So then what is the value of a function symbol f applied to terms t1 until tn? Well, we know that the interpretation assigns to every function symbol a function which takes the same amount of values as the function's arity. So then we have to supply to this function so many values. Well, and how can we obtain those values? By asking ourselves, well, what are then the values of the terms that we have supplied as argument? And that's what you see here. So whatever the value of t1 is under interpretation I and state sigma, that results in some value. And we continue doing that, and so then we have n values over here. Well, and those n values we can plug into the function fi, and that obtains us also a value. So that allows us then to assign to every term a value. And once every term has a value, we can then understand what is the meaning of a formula within an interpretation and a state. And we say that the meaning of a formula is defined in terms of whether it's satisfied or not, whether it's true or not. So within a particular interpretation I and within a particular state sigma, Let's say that the formula phi is satisfied or is true, and that is written as such, whenever the following conditions hold. So it is never the case for no interpretation and no state sigma, it is the case that the bottom formula representing falsehood is satisfied. And so that basically means that false is never true. In the case that, and again here we do it inductively on the structure of the formula. So from the abstract grammar we could see that the formula was either constructed being this bottom formula representing falsehood, or it was a relation symbol with n terms applied to it. Relation symbol R has arity n. Or it was this implication, or it was a universal quantification. Now in the case that we want to check whether the relation symbol R applied with n terms is satisfied in interpretation I in state sigma, well, what do we do? We ask ourselves, well, what are the values of the terms? And that gives you then a tuple, an n tuple of values. And then you can ask yourself, well, is that n tuple of values related by the interpretation of the relation symbol? And if that is then the case, then that formula is satisfied in the interpretation I in sigma, the state sigma. How to understand implication? Well, an implication is satisfied precisely when if the left hand side of the implication is satisfied, well, that then must imply in the same interpretation and state sigma that the right hand side of the implication is satisfied. And how do you then understand universal quantification? Well, a universal quantification of some formula phi is satisfied in interpretation I and state sigma if it is the case that if we update the state sigma, where we replace the value of variable x with an arbitrary value v, that then the formula phi is satisfied. And so this should hold for an arbitrary choice of v. So the satisfaction of phi should not depend on the value of v, and on the value of v. And if that is the case, then indeed the universal quantification over x is satisfied. Okay, so that gives you then the meaning of terms and the meaning of formulas. And now we can go back to our example of arithmetic. Let's say we take the standard interpretation of arithmetic. Yeah? So we have the integers and our relation symbol less than is interpreted as the less than relation. So then you can ask yourself the question, are the following formulas satisfied? Yeah? So is the following formula satisfied? Well, we first need, before we can ask ourselves whether this formula is satisfied, we need to have some state, because the satisfaction of a formula is with respect to an interpretation and a state. So without having a state, we cannot know whether this formula over here is satisfied. But let's say x is 1 and y is 5, right? Then is this formula satisfied in that state? Well, 1 indeed is smaller than 5. So this part is satisfied. So that should then imply that the right-hand side is satisfied. Well, 1 is not equal to 5. That is indeed the case. That is satisfied. And 5 is not smaller than 1, that's also satisfied, so the conjunction is satisfied. So the overall formula is satisfied. Yes, this is the case. Now, let's ask the question, is the formula over here satisfied? Well, in this case, we no longer have any free variables, so we can take an arbitrary state. And in an arbitrary state, in the standard interpretation of arithmetic, is this formula satisfied? Is it the case that for all x, if x is smaller than 5, that then x must be smaller than 4? Well, let's take 4 itself. So 4 is smaller than 5, but 4 is not smaller than itself. So no, this formula is not satisfied, because the formula within the brackets is not satisfied for an arbitrary assignment of the variable x in the state to an of the variable x in the state to an arbitrary value. So it is not satisfied. Is this formula satisfied? Well, again, we don't have free variables, so the state does not matter. Take an arbitrary state. And then we want to know, does there exist an x such that 0 is smaller than x? Well, yes, such an x exists. Let's take 1. And then indeed, 0 is smaller than 1. So this formula is satisfied. And is this formula satisfied? For all y, there exists an x such that y is smaller than x. This is indeed the case for arithmetic. Eh? So for any integer you can find, for any y that you have, there always exists a larger integer. Okay, so we have seen that these formulas are all satisfied, but this formula over here is not satisfied. So now you can ask yourself the question, can we change the interpretation so that all of these formulas are satisfied? And so we move away from the standard interpretation of arithmetic, and our intention is then to satisfy all these formulas. And the reason why I ask this question is because this is also how you should approach whenever you want to work with expert systems. Because you formulate in logic, in the language of first order logic, you formulate facts. And now the intention of this formulation of facts is that there must be an interpretation in which all those facts are indeed satisfied. So can we do that? Can we find an interpretation such that all of these formulas are satisfied? Well, yes, let's consider arithmetic, but not on all the integers, but only on the even integers. So that means we have the values 0, 2, 4, 6, but also minus 2, minus 4, minus 6, etc. Well, is it then still the case that if some x is smaller than some y, that then x must not be equal to y and y must not be smaller than x? Well, yes, this is still the case. And is it still the case that if you have some, is it still the case that there exists some value which is bigger than 0? Yes, you can take, for instance, 2 this time. And is it still the case that for every value y that there then exists an x that is bigger than it? Yes, that's still the case. Because you can always take, if you have a number y, then you can always take plus 2, and then there you have one bigger. But now the special one, namely this one, which was previously not satisfied, let's consider whether it is now satisfied. Is it the case that for every x, if x is smaller than 5, that then x must also be smaller than 4? Well, the question is, how do we interpret 5 now? Because in our new interpretation, where we only have the even integers, what is then the meaning of 5? And we have to assign to 5 an even integer. So let's say that we then interpret 5 as 4. Right, well, then this becomes trivial. Right? If x is smaller than 4, then x is smaller than 4. But if we, for instance, would interpret 5 as a 6, then it's no longer the case. Eh? Because then we could choose 4 here, because 4 is smaller than 6, but 4 is not smaller than itself. So whenever we interpret all the odd numbers, all the positive odd numbers, as by rounding them down to the even number that is below them, and for the negative numbers, we could maybe do something else. That's not necessary for this formula. So that shows to you that you can formulate facts in logic, and then you could try to understand, well, what interpretation would give the formulas that I mentioned? In what interpretation are all these formulas satisfied? And this is a general question. Another example in arithmetic. This is the usual signature that you have. And you have the constant 0, 1, 2, but now you have a unary minus symbol, and you have a binary plus, binary minus, times, divided by the relation symbols, the usual relation symbols. And then you can also ask yourself, okay, well, that was what we also previously did. If you give a formula and you have a fixed interpretation, in what state is that formula satisfied? Now, and in this case, I can give you an example how you could find out. You could, for instance, try out a number of states to figure out whether that works or not. So, for instance, consider the state where we assign the variable x to the value 1. Well, then indeed, it is the case that the relation on the left is 1 is bigger than or equal to 1. this one is satisfied. So then the right hand side must be satisfied as well. And 3 is smaller than or equal to 3, so then this part here must be satisfied. But is it the case that 1 plus 3, which is 4, is equal to 3 times 2? No, because 4 is not equal to 6. So in this state, this formula is not satisfied. And so you can now imagine that you just go through all the states that you can imagine and check whether in some of these states the formula is satisfied. And now it turns out, you could check this manually, but I already give you the answer. It turns out that in these states, the formula is satisfied. Because if x is 1, well, 1 is bigger than or equal to 1. And 1 is also smaller than 3. And 1 plus 1 is 2. And 1 times 2 is 2. So here we have 2 equals 2, that is satisfied. So in this state, the formula is satisfied. And in this state also, so 2 is indeed bigger than 1, and 2 is smaller than 3, and 2 plus 2 is 4, and 2 times 2 is also 4, so this is all satisfied. And in the case of 3, 3 as well, 3 is bigger than 1, 3 is smaller than or equal to 3, 3 plus 3 is 6, and 3 times 2 is also 6. Okay, so in the previous example, I asked the question, what is an interpretation such that these formulas are satisfied? And now I ask you the question, given a fixed interpretation, in what state is this formula satisfied? And both are basically questions that are known under the notion of what is satisfiability. So you could say a formula is satisfiable in general if there is some interpretation I and some state sigma for that interpretation I such that the formula phi is satisfied. And so then we call a formula in this case phi satisfiable. And now you can also have a different notion, namely a formula, let's say phi, is valid whenever it is the case that in all interpretations and in all states sigma of such interpretations, the formula phi is satisfied. And if you have these two definitions, then you can have the nice duality that a formula phi is valid if and only if the negation of that formula is not satisfiable. And furthermore, if formula is not valid if and only if the negation of that formula is satisfiable. So the question I just asked you, given these formula, is there an interpretation such that all these formula are satisfiable? It's an important question. And the other question, given a fixed interpretation, does there exist a state such that the formula is satisfiable, is also an interesting question. Well, turns out that in this satisfiability, we can generalize this satisfiability to a set of formula. So let gamma be a set of first order formula. So we no longer consider a single formula, but we consider a set of such formula. And now we can say that this set of first order formula is sound if every formula in that set gamma is valid. And we can say that the set gamma is complete if every valid formula phi is in gamma. So you can imagine this set of first order formula gamma to be called sound and complete whenever all valid formulas are in the set and whenever everything in the set is valid. Now, why do I say this? Well, because I want to work towards quite an important result which motivates a lot that happened afterwards in computer science. Namely, we can treat this sound and complete gamma as a formal language, because a formal language is a set of strings of symbols, and our formula are also strings of symbols. So whenever we treat gamma as a formal language, we can then ask ourselves the question, but is gamma then recognizable? And if gamma is recognizable, can we make it even more specific? Gamma is a formal language, is it decidable? And now we have the two landmark results, namely the Gödel's completeness theorem, which is, yes, there is a recognizable gamma that is sound and complete. But furthermore, we have a very important result by Church and Turing, which is the Church-Turing theorem. No, there is no decidable gamma that is sound and complete. And now, why do I say this? Whenever I was talking about the problem of satisfiability, well, now that we know that there is no decidable gamma that is sound and complete, but we do know that there is a recognizable gamma that is sound and complete, suppose that it would be possible that the satisfiable formulas also were recognizable, because we have the duality over here. A formula is not valid if this particular negation is satisfiable. If all the satisfiable formulas would be recognizable, then the formulas that are not valid would also be recognizable. But then we have that both the valid formulas and the invalid formulas are both recognizable, and that means that gamma would be decidable, but that is in contradiction with the Church-Turing theorem. So from the information on this slide, you could then deduce that satisfiability is not recognizable. So that means that it is a very difficult job for a computer to do. A computer cannot figure out itself on its own whether a given formula is satisfiable. So that is quite an important thing here. It's an impossibility result. But still, the question of whether something is satisfiable is an important question in practice. So if you ask yourself the question, is phi satisfiable? Well, then what can we do in practice? Well, lots of progress has happened in finding practical solutions, although it is in principle impossible for a machine to recognize satisfiable formulas. Eh? Because I just argued that that would then lead to a contradiction with the Church-Turing theorem. So if it is not the case that the satisfiable formulas are recognizable, what can we do in practice? Well, what we can do is we can try something out, right? As soon as you find an interpretation and a state, and as soon as you observe that a particular formula is satisfied in that interpretation and state, then you're done, right? So as soon as you found evidence of a formula being satisfiable, then you're done. And in practice, what you can do is, well, you can limit the interpretations. If you limit the interpretations to finite universes, well, and finite universes can perfectly be enumerated by machines, then you can start working with that, practically speaking. You could also say, let's fix the interpretation, right? So what we could do then is, for instance, what we did before, well, let's fix the interpretation to integer arithmetic. And then ask ourselves, well, is a particular formula within this fixed interpretation satisfiable? And that was the question we have already seen before. Eh? This formula, in what state is this formula satisfiable? Well, that's a very practical question. And you could maybe brute force it. Eh? You could just try out some states, or you could invent clever algorithms for looking at the structure of the formula to find out whether it's satisfiable. Well, this has happened in the past. I mean, it's an old problem, so to say. Yeah? So there is lots of practical solutions that have been developed in the meantime. And one particular technique that is used for fixing the interpretation is what is called satisfiability modulo theories, SMT. And SMT solving or finding out whether a formula is satisfiable within a fixed interpretation. Lots of progress has happened there. And there are competitions, SMT solver competitions, that are held among many research groups in the world that develop such algorithms for checking the satisfiability of formulas. And they try to compete with each other who can solve or who can find out the question who can find out the answer to the question, is my formula phi satisfiable, for the most formulas. So lots of progress has happened there in SMT. And then you can also, whenever you have limited the interpretation, fixed interpretations, you could search for a state. And this is a very, very specific and very interesting also quite deep field of computer science, which is the question of what is called model checking. And you could even do something more, and that is namely what happens if you limit the expressivity of the language. And by that I mean what happens if you take a subclass of formulas and then ask yourself the same amount of questions we have asked before. Well, and it turns out that if you, for instance, limit what you can quantify over, so you cannot just say for all x, but you must always specify a bound over which x potentially can range, and if that bound is always finite, then there are only finitely many values that such a variable could take. And then all the problems of satisfiability become very tractable and efficiently solvable. And that is, for instance, done what is called within bounded model checking. Now, these are very practical ways of dealing with this satisfiability problem, but why are they interesting in practice? Because there are widely used applications, and I will name two of them. So this whole question about satisfiability in the first place has developed into the field of databases. And the databases are at least foundationally bound, built on top of first order logic. And one of the original research papers out of which these ideas were developed can be found over here. I think it's actually quite a funny anecdote to tell here. I think it was this is a research paper that was funded by IBM, but it was for many years that the research paper was just out there. But there were no successful applications in the sense of that it had a lot of impact, but at some point clever engineers at the then obscure company called Oracle found the paper and started implementing it, and they built their own implementation, which was hugely successful in business. Another widely used application of satisfiability, the problem of satisfiability and the practical solutions that I just discussed, is in the field of hardware and software verification. And especially in hardware verification, this is very important because computer hardware in some way can be understood as being logical circuits, and these logical circuits you want to check, verify whether they satisfy certain properties. For instance, you want your processor that implements addition by having logic gates all etched in some kind of silicium wafer, implementing an arithmetic logical unit. You want to make sure that whatever is the design of such a circuit, that there is no error in that. Because if there is an error in your chip, you discover it, then you can throw away all your chips because there is an error in it. And every computer program that makes use of a processor which has an error, well, then potentially gives back an incorrect answer without possibly people noticing it. So in the field of hardware verification, being able to check whether a particular logical design satisfies your intended specifications is a satisfiability question. So that's a very, very important application of the question whether a formula is satisfiable. And also this applies to software verification, of course. I mean, what you can do in hardware, you can emulate or simulate in software. So same problems appear there. And you can improve the quality of software by asking yourself the question, well, is it indeed the case that my computer program satisfies a particular specification? Well, how could you do it? You can translate it all, this whole question, you can translate it all in the language of first order logic. And then ask yourself the question whether there is a particular logical relation that holds or not. And then the question of satisfiability, a positive answer amounts to the evidence of a run in which the computer program, for instance, crashes. And this is used even in practice, and it's actually quite funny, I should have put the link there, but it's used even in practice by hackers who analyze source code for very intricate code paths by using the satisfiability problem to discover whether or not, under checking certain conditions, to exploit, for instance, an incorrect program. So yeah, it has many important widely used applications. that's what I wanted to say. Thank you for watching this video, and I hope to see you soon again.